distraction is a big problem. People pick up their phones, they tap it, they swipe it, and they click it over 2,600 times a day. People are distracted. At work, workers on average waste 12 and a half hours every single week because they're tapping, swiping, and clicking, and they are distracted. 4,000 people every year in America get hurt because they're driving their car and they look down at the wrong time. And sadly, 4,000 people die every year in America because they are distracted. In business, $650 billion is wasted in America because people are not engaged in their work. They're not engaged in their life. So I don't want you to be distracted. All of my notes are at gregdwyer.com, so you don't have to take any notes. At the end of the lecture, you can go to gregdwyer.com and we'll give you all the notes, all of the facts, so that you can really be present and focus on what's important to you. So here's my promise. My promise is I'm going to show you how to stay focused so that you can get more done in your life. When I first started thinking about this 10 years ago, I really thought that the answer to focus was discipline and willpower. Because all of the books that I read said, as long as you're disciplined, as long as you're focused, you'll be able to accomplish things. It's like lighter fluid. Discipline's great, willpower is great, but they don't last. I found something that works 100% of the time. It's really simple. And I promise you, before 7 o'clock, I'm going to share that with you, and it's not going to be a secret, so that you can focus on what is important to you in your life. So I want you to think about what's important. I want you to think about why you're here. I asked a few people before to think about it, but I want you to focus on what's important to you. And then put everything aside, and if you could, stand up. Put your phones away, put your notes away, and just simply stand up. Everybody, stand up. Now, I want to show you how simple and easy it is to be distracted. It's really simple. So take your arm like this, you are at arm, Simon says. Close your fist. And then bring one finger up just like that. Okay, let's start over. That's your thumb. This is your finger. See how easy it is to get distracted? It's really easy. So this time, bring a finger up. Everybody play along. And then make a circle, like a circle between the fingers and the thumb. You see how I got a, circle right here? Take a look at your circle, right? Take your circle that you have and put it right on your chin. Okay, this is your chin. See how easy it is to be distracted. So when I do this in front of 10 people or 100 people or 1,000 people, I get different reactions. The first reaction I get are people that are very analytical, very detail-oriented. They tend to want to be right all the time. And they're like, I know this is not my chin, this is my chin. They're very detailed. They like to take things apart. They don't necessarily like to put things back together, but they like to be right all the time. How many of you can relate to that, or you know someone that's like that? Okay. The other type of person I meet when we do this is just having fun. They know they got it wrong, and they start laughing. They're here just to have a good time. How many of you can relate to that? Or you know people like that. You know, they just want to have a good time. There's other people that feel bad. Like, they literally feel bad that they got it wrong, but they're very empathetic in the sense that they feel bad for other people. How many of you can relate to that? Yeah, or you know people that are very empathetic. They wear their heart on their sleeve. And then there's the leader type. They're like, why are we doing this? This is stupid. I came here to learn about focus. Why are we playing these silly games? Maybe they did this and then they did this. But you know, they're the alpha male or the alpha woman. They're the ones that are out front and they're like, this is really stupid. How many of you can relate? Yeah, or you know people like that. Yeah, so now that I know a little bit about you, I want you to focus on why you came here tonight. And I want you to focus on what is important to you. And the way we're going to do that is we're going to use our imagination. And we're going to use visualization. So take your hands like this and make a circle. And I want you to imagine just for a moment that what you want is right here within this globe or circle. And I want you to visualize what you want. It could be health. It could be relationships. It could be money. It could be emotional health. It could be your career. Anything you want, I want you to visualize it. And as you visualize it, what I'm going to ask you to do is bring your hands closer and closer and closer together. Now, as you're doing this, I want you to believe that what you want is coming to you. And then what I'd like you to do is close your two hands like this, and then look at your thumbs. And the reason I want you to look at your thumbs and focus on the thumbs, because if your right thumb is over the left, it's a good indication you're gonna get what you want. It's like 97%. Now, if the left thumb is over the right, it means you're really good looking. You're probably not gonna get it, but it's okay, you really don't care. All right, let's try it again. This time, if you put your right over your left, I want you to switch it. And if your left is over the right, I want you to switch it. So think about what you want, and only you know, keep it a secret. And then bring your fingers and your hands together and visualize that you're gonna get what you want by bringing this together, 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 together. But this time, do the thumbs differently. And then bring your hands together like that. Now, this is what I know for certain. I have no doubt about this. This is not a joke. If it feels uncomfortable, if it feels different, that's because to get what you want, you're going to have to do different things. Definitely. So here's the first different thing we're going to do. Hold both hands out like this with the thumbs facing up towards the ceiling, and then take your left arm and then put it over the right, just like this. If you can do it. Some people have a hard time doing this. And then what you want to do is you want to bring your hands down like this, your thumbs down towards the floor, and then you're going to hold it just like this. And now if you're doing it correctly, and I can't see everybody in the room, but if you're doing it correctly, your pinkies are at the top, your thumbs are at the bottom, so you can see your thumbs at the bottom. Now, what you want to do is you want to look to see which thumb is on top of the other. The way you do it is look at me and just do this. Bring it around just like that. Okay, you can have a seat, have a seat. So I'm going to teach you how I did that, because I used to be a magician. I'm no longer a magician. If I was a magician, I wouldn't show you this. But believe it or not, if you go to Vegas and you see David Copperfield, this is how he opens his show, with nothing in his hands. In fact, the last time I saw him was in January. I was seated right there. I paid $150 for the ticket. And as I looked up, I could see exactly what he was doing. So this is what he did. Now, you have to promise me that you're not going to tell people, but I'll show it to you. I'll show you exactly what he did. So you can follow along in your seat, or you can just watch. It's up to you. So what I did is I asked you to take your left arm and put it over the right. And then I asked you to go like this. And you all were following me because you've never done this before. So it's easy to distract you because, I mean, how many of you have done this before? And then I said, all right, now take a look at the pinkies. The pinkies should be at the top. Now, the thumbs are at the bottom, I said. I don't know if you heard me say that. And at that point, you look down at your thumbs, because I went like this, and I let go of my hands. And when I let go of my hands, I did this, and then I brought it over. You were distracted because you were following. You can't follow everything. So that's how David Copperfield, believe it or not, just distracts 500 people in the audience. So this time when I do it, you know what I'm gonna do. So when I do this and I let go of my fingers and I point to the thumb, I want you to focus on that, all right? So everybody do it with me, Left, over the right, got it, everybody? And then move your hand like this. Now at that point I said, look at your pinkies, right? And you all looked at your pinkies. And then I said, what did I say, remember? Look at your thumbs. And at that point, what did I do? I let go, right? But I don't have to let go because I already did. Now you can do this. So this raises the question of multitasking. Should we multitask? Well, it's possible to cook dinner, do the laundry, and talk on the phone all at the same time. But this is what the research shows. Multitasking is an illusion. We're really not good at it at all. Have you ever talked to somebody on the phone and you know they're not listening because they're scrolling through social media? You're like, are you listening to me? Or worse yet, maybe you're on the phone and you're scrolling through social media and you know that you're not paying attention. So what I've learned is this. I do a lot of speaking for businesses in corporate America and nonprofit and fundraising companies, especially on the focus of customer service, because so many people are distracted because they're listening to people and they're picking up their phones and they're all over the place and people know it. So in corporations and in businesses, it's important to be present with people. So like, what's your first name?
Paulina.
So Paulina, if I was to talk to you, I wouldn't be looking at my watch, right? I wouldn't be looking at my phone. I'd be looking at you and having a conversation with you because all I really see is her. And believe it or not, like if I bring my hands out like this, I really can't see my fingers unless I move to the left or right. So if I'm looking at Paulina, focusing on her lets her know what? She's important. So if I'm talking to you and I'm like, oh, hold on one second, I got a call, or okay, yeah, what? I'm letting her know that she's not that important. Yeah. So multitasking in relationships is dangerous. Behind the wheel, when you're driving your car, it's even more dangerous. Remember, 4,000 people die every single year just because they try to do that. So multitasking is an illusion, and all I can say is all of the research says this. Whatever you're focusing on, if it's really, really important to you, then just focus on that. Whether it's your loved one or your children or your employer or your employee or the person you're serving or the salesperson you're talking to, that's really, really, truly important. So let me show you what I mean. I'd like you to take your right foot and put it out just like this. And if you could, put it out, think of a clock, a circle, put it at 7 o'clock. So you have to imagine, we're using our imagination. And then what I'd like you to do is bring it up to 12, and then move your right foot clockwise as it's going around in a circle. So it's going around in a circle. So you started at 7 o'clock, then you went to 12, and you just kept on going. At the same time, hold your finger up in the air, pointing in the air, your right hand. And what I'd like you to do is, while you've got your foot going around clockwise, I would like you to move your finger the other direction, which is counterclockwise. I've done this hundreds of times. I've never seen anybody be able to do both of those things at the same time. Now, here's the reason. We're limited. I'm limited. We're all limited. We're totally limited. There was a guy by the name of George Miller. He wrote a paper called The Magical Number of 7. How many?
7.
And what he said was, there's billions of bits of information coming at us every second. Every second. Billions and billions of bits of information. But we can only focus on how many? 7. Give or take a couple. We can't focus on everything. It's completely impossible. Like, we can't focus on that sign in the back that says exit because you're looking up here. And there's hundreds and thousands of things that are going on, you know, in this room that you're not paying attention to because they're just not important to you. And to think that we can pay attention to everything and to think that we can multitask, it's just not true. So there was an experiment done on the internet. Maybe you've seen it. It's called the Monkey Business Illusion. where they have two teams and they're passing the basketball between the two teams. And they ask you to count the passes between the one team. And as you count the passes, it's 16. 16. And then they say this, did you see the gorilla? Because what happens is, as you're counting the passes of the basketball, this guy in a gorilla suit, like 6'7", walks out, and you can Google this letter, by the way, it's all in my notes, so don't worry about that. He goes like this, and he walks off the stage, and only 50% of the people watching the video or saw it live were able to see the gorilla. It's unbelievable. So it would be like this. I don't have a gorilla, but it'd be like this. If I asked you to look around the room for everything that was red, seven, let's just play seven. Seven things that were red. Well, I have a red diamond here. This is red. If you're close enough, you can see the red on the tape because I have a notebook. My socks have a little red in them, right? So there's red over here in the notebook. Where else is red? Can you see? There's got to be a fire. Well, usually the exit signs are red, but oh, the flag. So we're up to seven things. Now, if I said, hey, let's think of seven things that were blue. Oh, immediately. I would go to the flag, because that's easy. Any other things? Oh, the marble over here. Right? And then if I said, yeah, and then, oh, that too, yeah, the Connecticut flag. Then if I said, now here's the thing. If I said, now think of another seven things that are red, and another seven things that were blue, you would be completely overwhelmed. You wouldn't be able to keep it, because we can't. It's impossible. So back to the monkey business illusion. They sat everybody down and they said, listen, we want you to look at the monkey. This time, focus on the monkey. You're going to see the monkey. So they're passing the ball, and you're supposed to look at the monkey. And you see the monkey. Everybody in the room sees the monkey. Everyone. And then they said, did you notice that the red curtain turned to orange? Did you notice that one person walked off the team and never came back? And nobody noticed. Because it's impossible to take in everything. Years ago, I was in Israel. I was in Bethlehem because I do tours. I take people on retreats because I want to take them out of their environment so they can focus on their life. So my tour guide said to me back in 95, are you okay, Greg? And I said, yeah, I'm a little overwhelmed. There's just too much information. There's too much red. There's too much blue. There's too much this. There's too much. There's just too much. Culture shock. Overwhelmed. It's just too much. He said, be careful of the tricksters. I said, who are the tricksters? He said, the pickpockets. I said, the magicians? He said, no, they're better than David Copperfield. Because if they don't take your wallet, they're not going to eat. True story. A couple years later, we're in Bethlehem, and I'm leading a tour, and the whole bus walks out of this store to get on the bus. So we walk out of this gift shop. And there's like seven people hanging around, and eventually this one guy from Nebraska is standing over here, away from the bus, and these group of people circle him. Everyone had something to sell him. Postcard, scarf, you name it. And I said to him, get on the bus, follow me, I'm the guy, I've done this for 10 years, please stop, don't buy from those guys, please get on the bus. It's a true story. He doesn't listen. Finally, he gets on the bus. That night at dinner, he comes up to me, opens up his wallet, all of his money's gone. True story. Now, the good news is we had a camera on the shop, so we were able to play it back and figure out who took the money. But what happened was, he wanted to buy this flute for $1, and in his mind, he thought it was the most important thing. For me, I thought the most important thing was him to get on the bus, but he didn't think that. He was over here. No amount of my willpower worked. None of my discipline worked. None of his internal dialogue worked. He was stuck on buying that flute for $1. He didn't realize it cost him everything until, of course, we got his money back. And then I began to think about this. Why is it that he didn't listen? How come willpower and discipline didn't help my friend from Nebraska? And then I thought about it. There's two invisible forces that work in our favor or against us. And they are beliefs and values. So, think of a triangle. Everybody think of a triangle. So in his mind, the flute was the most important thing for $1. He was over here, he had postcards and scarves, and he's like, I'm gonna buy this flute, you know? But for him, at the very top of the triangle was this deal that he thought was so important. So what he valued, you know, like, think of values, you know, I value this, but this is what I really value. And then he had beliefs running in the background that I would say were invisible to him, and actually invisible to me, because I didn't know. And that would have to do with thinking. That's the T, and it's inside the triangle because we don't see the thinking. But we do hear the words, and we hear or see the actions. So the invisible force that was working against me on the trip and against him losing his money were his belief and what he valued. I couldn't believe it. And then I did some research around this, and this is what was shocking. And again, this is all in my notes. On average, we have 45, this is going to shock you, to 65,000 thoughts every single day. So today is Tuesday. And some, today's 21st of June. So today, we have on average 45 to 65,000 thoughts. Wait for it. 90% of what you're thinking today, you're going to think tomorrow. I couldn't believe it. So here I am trying to influence this guy. I didn't have a chance. Because of what he valued, think of a triangle, right? What he valued and his beliefs, his words, what he was saying to himself, I gotta get this food. The food's only a dollar. I'm not listening to this guy. He's 20 years younger than me. I'm not gonna listen to him. So his thoughts, words, actions were taking him on autopilot in a certain direction. TWA, remember that? So he was on autopilot, like you are, and like I am. 45 to 65,000 thoughts every single day. We take the same routes to see people, we wear the same clothes, we eat the same food, we have the same conversations. And 90% of what we're thinking, we are going to repeat tomorrow. And we're wondering why we can't get what we want. Like, I really want this thing. But here are some invisible forces that are working against us. It reminds me of the movie, I don't know if you've seen it. It's called Groundhog Day. I love this movie. This is one of my favorite movies. The guy in the movie is full of himself. His name is Phil, Bill Murray. And the thing that he values the most is himself. He is so selfish. And his thoughts, his words, his actions, everything is about him. I don't know if you've seen the movie, but he goes to Punxsutawney. He's got to fill the groundhog, and he doesn't really care. He doesn't care about anybody. The only person he really cares about is himself. So he wakes up on Groundhog Day. The radio goes off, if you've ever heard or seen the movie. Rise and shine, campers, and don't forget your booties, because it's cold outside. It's Groundhog Day, and then Sonny and Cher. So he gets up, he walks over, and he sees everybody going to Nobbler Hill to celebrate this groundhog. Day one, right? And then the next day, the alarm goes off, rise and shine, campers, and don't forget your booties, because it's cold outside. And he goes, they're playing yesterday's track. They're idiots. They're playing yesterday's track. He's playing yesterday's track. And so he doesn't recognize it until the next day, and the next day, and the next day. And then eventually he realizes that he is playing yesterday's track over and over and over. And the interesting thing about it is he tries discipline, he tries willpower, he can't break the spell. As long as what's important to him is himself, it's all about him, and his thoughts, words, and actions support that, invisible forces, he'll try everything, nothing will ever change until he changes. So, you're probably thinking about patterns in your own life. You know, people that you talk to all the time, things you do, things you say, the way you drive, you have patterns. We all have these patterns. I have these patterns. When I first heard this, I was like, oh my goodness, I can't believe this. So I want you to think about your patterns, but before you get into it, here's what I'd like you to do. Think of a number between 1 and 10, like 3, but not like 3. Most people, they think of 7. They do. And one of the reasons why is because I talked about the magical number 7. I also told you to put your foot out at 7. I've also used illustrations of 7, by the way. There were 7 people that were surrounding this guy. So throughout the lecture, the number 7 has been very predominant. This lecture has been brought to you by number 7. All right, now I want you to think of a color. Actually, let's do 2 colors. Think of, okay, so most of you thought of red and blue. Most people do. And besides, if you don't think of it, I also talked about red and blue because we looked around the room for all of these things. And then I want you to think of 2 different simple geometric shapes, not like a square, but one inside the other. Most of you thought of a triangle and a circle. And if I want to be honest with you, when I first came out, I was talking about the circle. And I was also talking about the triangle. So these are all patterns that are in the lecture to let you know that you have been conditioned. But the truth is you've been conditioned anyway by your own thoughts, by your own words, and by the media, and by people that we know. We've all been conditioned by all of these things. So how do we break the spell? Well, first of all, it's easy to be distracted. The door's moving, we hear the railroad. There's so many things that can distract us, and we can be all over the place. You know, if you watch television, the camera moves every 3 seconds, internet moves. It's to keep us intact because it's easy to be distracted. Number 2, we also know that multitasking doesn't work. It doesn't work. It's impossible to do it. And we also know that we have been conditioned. So if all of these things are working against us, how can we get what we really want? And then it dawned on me. And this is what I want to share with you. I started as a magician back in 4th grade, from 4th grade all the way up to high school. Magic was everything to me. I worked backstage with Doug Henning. I didn't think about anything except magic. And then I decided to go a different path altogether, get a couple master's degrees. I always loved magic, but I realized I didn't want to spend my life deceiving people, entertaining people, and really taking advantage of people. And I didn't want the lifestyle. So I decided to go elsewhere for 25, 30 years. But then it hit me. What if I could show people how they are being distracted, just like David Copperfield does, and help them to stay focused so that they can get the love that they want, they can get the relationships they want, that they can get the money they want, that they can get the house that they want. You know, these are the things that are important to people. So this is the reason why I'm here. So what I'm going to share with you is really simple, and it comes down to 3 words. Importance, importance, direct, focus. Where willpower fails and where discipline fails, this works 100% of the time. So let me give you an illustration. Does anybody smell smoke? So if we started smelling smoke and hearing the sirens, and feeling the heat on our back, we'd say, Greg, I know you're a nice guy, but we're out of here. So importance would direct your focus. You'd say, hey, look, I gotta get out of here. I gotta look for the exits, because that's the most important. Forget this lecture, forget, you know, I gotta get out of here. So what I discovered is this is the key that sets people free, is number 1, they have to determine what's truly important to them. Because if we don't do the work, then other people are going to come along and tell us what's important. So here's my formula for success when it comes to focus. Number 1, you have to know what's important. Now, that could be lofty, like, well, how do I know what's important in my life? You know, like, we're going into summer, the second half of this year will make me think about, well, what's important for the second half of this year? Or what's important for next year? Or what's important for today? Or what's important for tomorrow? When I travel, that I haven't traveled for a while, I have never, ever had people take any of my belongings. I've had people bump up to me. I've had people tap me. I've had people you know, kind of fake, drop a wallet and say, sir, is this your wallet? Because they want to know where my wallet is, you know? But when I traveled, I knew that the number one thing for me was my passport. I mean, I would bring money and I'd bring a cell phone and camera and all that stuff. But for me, the first thing I did is I identified what was important to me. Second is I kept it a habit. So I've been all over Europe. I've traveled. I've been to the Louvre. I've been to Italy. I've been to Greece. I've been to Germany. I've been all over the world. And number one, before I leave, I say, hey, this passport's important. And number two, I got to put it in the same place. I have to make it a habit. It's got to be a habit. Because I've seen people, one day, the passport is in the back pocket. The next day, it's in their pillow. The next day, it's in their bank's vault or whatever. And they can't figure out where it is because they're like, there are too many things going on. So I said, okay, the key to traveling safety is to know what is important, and number two, make a habit. And then number three is to keep it a secret. In other words, I wouldn't tell people at all what I had and where I was hiding. So in life, what I figured out was the same thing applies for you, for me, for all of us. But most of us don't take the time to really reflect. And by the way, this is the secret that I want to share with you before 7 o'clock. And it's the secret that shifts everything. How many of you want to know what it is? Okay, it's a secret, I can't tell you. But the secret is, well, let me tell you a story. It's better illustrated. Let me just sit down. It's better illustrated by a story. When I was in high school, and I grew up in New Fairfield, Connecticut. I live in Litchfield. I love New England. I love Fairfield County. I love being here. I also love the guy by the name of Harry Houdini, he's buried not too far from here, actually. And he died on Halloween 1926 at 1:26 in the afternoon. This is how much I love this guy. And I would focus on this guy's career, but in the prime of his life, he was in London. And he was challenged to escape from a safe, a bank vault. So he said, okay, you know, let me think about this. All right, I'm gonna do it. I'm gonna escape from the bank vault. And so they brought the bank vault, true story, on the stage, opened up the door, and he got out. Wow. So, how did he do it? Now, just imagine this. Use your visualization, your imagination. You're in a theater with 500 people. This guy, 5'2", walks out, really short little guy. And the safe is opened, and then he gets in, you know. And the door is closed, locks, they bring up a curtain. And I'll tell you, in those days, you had no internet, you had no television, right? So people would wait for hours to see your guy get out of the safe, right? It's a different world. Totally different. People wouldn't wait around for that at all. They'd be on their cell phones. How'd he do it? So I'd like you to reflect on this. Just kind of go inside and reflect and see what comes to you. How did he do it? Well, the question is distracting because how is not the right answer or the right question at all. How is not important because the real question is, what is a safe for? What's a safe for? It's to keep people out, not in, right? Have you ever got locked outside of your car? It's crazy. It's like, oh, I gotta call AAA or whatever. But many of us probably haven't got locked inside of our car. So Harry Houdini thought differently. He thought differently. He knew what was important. He didn't dabble. He didn't say, oh, Bess, you know, maybe I should escape from the safe. I'm not really sure if I should do it. I got other things going on. Like, he was really focused on one thing. He wasn't focused on 10 things. This was the height of his career. If he didn't get out of the safe, oh, his career could have been over. So for him, he knew what the outcome was. The most important thing to him was to get out of the safe. And he had had a habit of saying this over and over and over and over like an affirmation. My brain is the key that sets me free. My brain is the key that sets me free. And Harry Houdini thought differently than the masses, where most people, 99.9%, were habitually saying, how did he do it? He was saying, what's a safe for? A safe is to keep people out, not in. The other thing is Harry Houdini had the safe taken to the stage a day early. So he had 24 hours to get in the safe and to examine the safe from the inside out. He had time. He had time to reflect. He also had time to make a tiny little key that he would use from the inside out so it would look like a miracle. That's how Harry Houdini escaped. He thought differently from the masses. And the one thing he did was he reflected. So here's my secret. This isn't a diamond. It's a triangle. That's all it is. It's a triangle. And this lower half is a reflection of the top half. So if you have your thoughts, right? T, W, your words, your actions. This is what it would look like. Reflection. So the secret, it's simple. It's not rocket science. It's reflection. How many people take time in the day just to reflect on your thoughts? A dog can't do it. You know, a cat can't do it. Most people don't do it. And that's why most people are distracted. So, the key is simple. It's just reflect on your thoughts, your words, and your actions. And the reason why you set an intention could be anything. Whatever the intention is, whatever it is to change how you think and what you say and how you act. This has to support this. And so this is reflection. So let me show you what I'm talking about. Everybody stand up. I know you've been sitting for a while. Take your hands like this. Take your hands like this. Think about what you want, because now we're getting really, really focused here. What you want, what you want, what you want, what you want, what you want. Think about what you want. Think about it right now. And then take your hands like this and hold up your two index fingers. And in between your two fingers, I want you to imagine that a magnet is pulling them together, and as you're reflecting about what you want, your fingers are coming closer and closer and closer and closer and closer and closer together. How many of you did it, right? So, there's an exercise in reflection. It's, you know, it's a little corny, but nevertheless, it's a great metaphor for reflection. So everybody have a seat for a second. Every day, Monday through Friday, I reflect, and we do this, here, let me hand you the key that you already hold in your hand. If you've ever daydreamed when you're driving, you do this, everybody does this. I don't know if people do this in a way that's every single day, but this is the magic formula, because what you're doing is you're reflecting upon your thinking and your words and your actions, and then you're making adjustments. You're making adjustments. So, ma'am, the one that's taking notes, what is your name? Because I want to ask you a few questions if you're okay with me working with you. Is that okay?
Sure.
What's your name?
Karen.
What is it?
Karen.
Karen. Would you join me on stage? I promise not to embarrass you. It'll be fun. We'll have a great time together. Give her a hand, Karen. I guess you got to come up over here. The stairs are over here. So this is another example. This is a pocket watch. This is another example. You can see I'm right here, and I promise not to embarrass you. Are you from Connecticut? Oh, good. So this is a pocket watch. There's no magic tricks. There's no magnets. There's no strings. This is just a metaphor. So the metaphor is this. Thoughts, words, and actions, the TWA. So let's say I'm thinking a circle. And without really moving, it kind of moves in a circle. Like, I'm doing it. Like, it's not witchcraft, I assure you. It's not even magic. It's just, it's the muscles in my brain. I mean, I can do this and it would be a miracle. Think about it. But I can also say, all right, rock goodbye baby, right? I can do that as well. Watch. I'm taking my thoughts, my words, things I'm saying to myself, and I'm saying back and forth, rock goodbye baby. Ta-da. So, this is a metaphor for taking our thoughts, words, and actions and aligning them. So I want you to think about why you came here, and I don't know, and I want you to think about what's important to you, and then I want you to hold the watch with either hand, and let's do a lie detector just to find out. So you're going to shake your head yes and no, and I promise not to embarrass you, and I promise not to ask you anything personal. It's just simple stuff. We're just going to calibrate where she's at, Karen's at. You'll shake your head yes or no. Are you in Connecticut now? Yes. Okay. So she shook her head, and then it moved. All right. Then I'm going to ask you something that's completely false. Are you in Canada? Are you in Canada right now? And it kind of moves a little differently. So let's do this. I have one over here. Let me get mine. So did you notice a difference at all? In the way it moved? Okay, all right. So believe me, this takes practice. This doesn't happen all the time. So why don't you stand a little bit forth like this, good. And I'm just holding it out here to see if we could get it going the same way. So I'm thinking rock-a-bye baby. Let's see, and think, why don't you think of that too? Just think, as you see mine going back and forth, maybe you'll be influenced by it, and then you'll also be influenced by your thoughts as well, thinking that it's going back and forth. Okay, good. Now, let's try this. This is baby steps. You gotta do baby steps. I'll hold it out like that. And then what I'd like you to do is just think of a number between 1 and 10, or 1 and 12. Just say it out loud.
11.
Okay, great. So think of 11 and see if you can count it 11 times. Is that 1, 2, 3, 4, I'm not sure, are you at 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. What is she at 10, 11? What is she at? I don't know. Has anybody got it?
10.
I think she's at 10. Excellent. So, you don't have to get a pocket watch and do this, but this is an illustration of how your thoughts, words, and actions can impact you. Now, here's the interesting thing. Do you know what's important to you? Don't tell me, but you know, because we want to keep it a secret. What I have found, and this is profound, this is the real magic that I've kind of come into, is if you get really focused on what's important to you and you meditate, I'm not saying you have to join a monastery, it's not that sort of thing, or you daydream, or you just reflect on it every single day, you'll start to see things happen which will get you closer and closer and closer to what you want and not what you don't want. So I'm looking at the time. Boy, we only got about 10 minutes. But I do remember you saying the number 11. Open up your watch. You just pop it at the top. And then we're going to give her a big hand. Just pop it like this watch. Pop, pop, pop. Just pop it. Just pop it. See, just pop it.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, just pop it. No, 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 no.
No,
no, let me
go.
You got it. What time is it?
11
o'clock, you're right. Does that say 11 o'clock? Okay, it says 11 o'clock. Karen, be careful as you go down the stairs. I don't have insurance. So, here's what I figured out, and I want to be on time, so we're going to do this really quick. This is what I found out as far as how to change and to get focused. Number one, you have to know what you want. So, here's my illustration. I want to write a book, and I'm in the process of writing a book, because I believe that writing a book will advance my career. More people will see me on Amazon, or I'll get other bookings, you know, things like that. However, if my thoughts, words, and actions don't support what I want, I'll probably never write the book. So if I'm over here going, well, who's going to read a book from me? You know, I only got a 3.2 average, but I do have a couple master's degrees, but you know, I don't know, books have been written about focus before, you know, most people only sell like 100 books, maybe I can put it in the libraries. So my thoughts, my words, and my actions, if they don't support what I want, I won't get it. I'll be struggling. I'll be like the guy over here getting on the bus, and he's not on the bus, and he's losing all his money because he just can't get it together. So the reason why you set an intention is so that you can change your TWA. You can stop it from going autopilot, and you have the opportunity to have it go in different directions. And the way that I was able to do this is with a deck of cards. This is a deck of cards. And they're special. They're not ordinary. Every single card has a different saying on it. Like, for instance, this one says, the real beauty is within you. This one says, make your passion a lifestyle. So every single card is different. It's a 52 deck, but every card says something different. They're not for sale. Eventually they will be. But right now, what I do is I use these cards to condition my mind. If it's true that we have 45 to 65,000 thoughts a day and 90% of them are the same, this helps me. And by the way, I just read recently, I can't believe this, depending on who you listen to, 43 to 48% of our life is habitual. Let that sink in. So I read this last week. 43 to 48% of our life is habitual. Let me say that again, that's a joke. But here's the deal. If it's true, then I can change it. All I have to do, you're a magnet for happiness. There's another one. All I have to do is condition my mind. All I have to do is change my mind. All I have to do is reflect. All I have to do is figure out what's important. All I have to do is condition my mind. So, it looks like magic, but it's not. It's knowing what you want, and then condition your thoughts, words, and actions. So, you in the back, what's your name again?
Sandra.
Sandra, come on up. I want to show you a demonstration. I promise not to embarrass you. Give her a hand. Give her a hand so that she's encouraged to run to the stage. So I want you to take a look at this and take a look at the cards. Just take a look at them really quick. They're all different, all different, all different. You like them, they're good, you know. Right now I pay $25 a deck for these. Eventually, if I can get it down to maybe 5 or 10, I'll sell them for a reasonable price of $100 a piece. All right, so what I'd like you to do is I want you to think about what you want, but don't tell me. Just don't tell anybody. You really need to keep this a secret. And then, as you're keeping it a secret, I'd like you to just go through the cards and just let one pop out like this with your intuition, without looking. So you're not going to look. You're not going to look at the. Oh, I like this one. You're just kind of going through the cards, and I really got to get out of here at 7. So let's go with this card. You know, that's one of those ones. Okay. So, and then we're not going to look at it. We're going to keep it hidden. So go ahead. Just pick a card, any card that you want. Choose it. Don't look at it. Keep it a secret. Don't even show me. Okay. Which card you got? All right, so I'm going to give it to you, man. So just slide the one card into this envelope. Excellent. And I'm going to give it to you. All I promise, or all I ask you to do, is not open it up, okay? And you trust it, right? All right, good. Now I want you to stand right over here. Yes. And I want you to imagine. I want you to imagine, as you're facing the wall of what you want, close your eyes, and imagine that what you want is far away from you, is black and white, is something that you're never going to get. So open your eyes. So how do you feel right now?
Fine.
Okay, on a scale of 1 to 10, how confident do you feel that you're going to get what you want? 1 being low, 10 being high.
8.
Okay, excellent. So, I want you to take this lock and this key, and I want you to open the lock with the key. How are you feeling now? What's your emotions? How are you feeling?
Frustrated.
Okay, frustrated. That's where I want you. All right, so she's frustrated. Excellent. Now think about what you want and think about being frustrated. Think about what you want and think about being frustrated. Are you still at an 8?
7.
I have 7. See how easy it is to influence people? Now, we do this to ourselves. Whatever. We say certain things, we act a certain way, and we put ourselves into a hypnotic trance. So, stand over here with me. Now, shoulders back, in a superwoman's position, women's power. Close your eyes, see it in living color, whatever it is, it's bright, it's loud. You feel it in your heart, you can feel it in your emotions. And you know that you're not a 7, you know that you're not an 8. What do you feel now?
10.
You're 10, okay, great. Here, open that lock.
Open the.
I totally forgot. I'm running late. I just got a little crazy. So we got this card for you. Open up the envelope and take a look at the card. Don't tell me about it. I don't want to see it.
Okay.
All right. Do you see it? Don't say it, but think of it to yourself.
Do I look at it?
Oh, by the way, look in the envelope. Is there something else in the envelope?
Yes.
What is in the envelope?
A key.
A key! All right, so try the key in the lock. How do you feel about what you want now?
I can have it.
Okay. Now, you didn't tell me what was written on that card.
No.
And you picked it. And you didn't tell me what you're thinking of. However, I will tell you, did you look at the card?
No.
Okay. I didn't either, but why don't you look at it? Do you think by looking at that card that would impact you, influence you, condition you to get to you what you want?
Yes.
So, I have spoken all over the world, and you know money is not the issue for most people. I know people that are multimillionaires. They're terrible in their relationships. They're terrible in what's going on in their life. They're not happy. So money is not the issue for you, is it?
No.
No, I didn't think so. And I'll tell you why, because most people don't really want the money, and it's not even what the money can bring them. It's not. It's the happiness, knowing. It's an emotional thing. That's what I'm feeling. And just daydream for a minute. I don't know who this is or what this is, but I'm getting feelings, and I'm picking up on something that's not tangible. In other words, you can't really put it in a box or a wheelbarrow. You can't really classify it by saying, it's not a noun. I'm feeling it's a verb. And that you can and you will. Does that mean anything to you?
Yes.
Okay, good. So you know that you're a 10. And you were over here as a 7, and then you were frustrated, but now you feel differently. And I just want you to know that what you really truly want, wants you.
Good.
And it's love.
Yes.
Thank you. Give her a hand. Thank you. Watch yourself as you go down the steps. Thank you so much. So, in business, in relationships, in sales, in marketing, in anything, it's all about rapport. It's all about rapport. You want to be able to pick up on other people's feelings. The reason why most of us can't do this is because we're so focused on ourselves. And if we're focused on ourselves, we can't pick up vibes from other people. We can't pick up hints. We don't listen to what they're saying. The average person is not going to tell us what's important to them. They're going to keep it a secret. So we don't know what's important to them. So it's really a secret. God. The clues that we have is things that they say tells, or the actions that they say. And if we're not focused on ourselves, and we're focused on them, you know, see, this is what I learned. In the West, the focus is, especially Fairfield County, especially New England, it's all about getting things done, working in and having, being successful. And in the West, it's about results. This is masculine energy. And when I say masculine energy, I could be talking about a woman, a male, a child, any person. How's that for any person? I'm going to get this done. All right, that's masculine energy. This is the West. This is New England. This is New York. In the East, comes easier. In the East, it's about reflection. And the reflection brings about the connection. And so the connection is, I'm not focused on me, 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 me. Because that's a lot of suffering. It's a lot of suffering. Believe me. But when you focus on me, and you focus on other people, you'll start to see the connection that will truly make you happy. And it's all about the rapport. It's all about the rapport. We're going to end with this. So one more demonstration, the lady in the back. Please come up, give her a hand. What is your name?
Brooke.
I'm sorry?
Brooke.
I think she said Brooke. So, rapport. A lot of times what we try to do is we try to get rapport with, oh, do you like the Yankees? Yeah, not me either, right? Do you like the Red Sox? Are you a baseball fan, football fan? No? No, I'm not either. So, we try to get rapport that way, you know? And we try it with our words. However, a better way is matching and mirroring. It's like when I call libraries or I call businesses and I pick up the phone and I call them up and they go, hello, H&R Block. I go, hi, it's Greg Dwyer. I match it, I mirror it. I'm entering into the person's world, and that's what I'm attempting to do right now. So, you understand?
Mm-hmm.
Are you from Connecticut originally?
No.
No. Where are you from?
Originally from Minnesota.
Minnesota? What brought you here to Connecticut?
My father's job.
Oh, okay. What kind of work?
Corporate
return. Wow. Wow. My father did blue collar in Fairfield. So what was it like being with a dad, that kind of work as an attorney? What was that like? Was he ever home or not home? Or?
It was a very nice life.
It was? Oh, good. Excellent. All right. So what I'm looking to do is to build rapport, to find something in common. So there was a movie. I don't know if you remember it, but it was called Magic. Anthony Hopkins was in it, and the other person that was in it was Margaret, what's her name? Help me out here, I'm having a senior moment. Anne Margaret, I don't know if you saw them, 1978, I was in high school. Did you see the movie? Okay, so Anthony Hopkins is this young guy, and he wants to impress the girl, so he wants to build rapport, you know? So he has two decks of cards. She pulls a card, he pulls a card, and they're the same card. But it's just a card trick. Because he pulls his card after her. So he knows. He just has, you watch the movie, you can figure it out. So I have two decks of cards here. I'll give you one. Take a look. Take a look, take a look, take a look, take a look. Why don't you stand over here and I'll stand over there. We'll switch. So every single one of my deck cards are different, as you can see. And yours, they're all different. And we'll just kind of give them a little shuffle. Just shuffle them up. You wouldn't believe the mess I had before the lecture. They were all over the floor, and it was my fault. So you take a look at my deck, I'll take a look at yours, and you let me know if you feel comfortable with the deck. And now, you can keep that. Okay, so face everybody. So think about what you want, what you came here for, what the thing you thought about before you got up on stage when I asked you before the lecture to think about one thing. So think about that one thing. And as you're going through the deck, and I'm going to show you first. Watch me, because I'm going to go first. I'm actually going to go first. So you're going to mirror me. You're going to match me. So I'm thinking about what I want, but I'm also thinking about what you want, which I don't know. But I know most people. Believe it. I've met thousands of people, more than that. So I'm going to do this. I'm going to just go through the deck. And reflect. Like, that's what I'm really doing. Yeah. And I'm going to go... I'm not going to look at it. I'm not going to look at it. So you're going to do the same thing in a moment. So watch me. So I'm going to put this... here. And you do the same. So just kind of reflect on what you want. Reflect on what you want. And then stop and call. You already stopped?
No.
Okay, go ahead. No, don't look, please. Please don't look. You want to use your intuition, and you want to use reflection, and you want to trust your imagination. Got what? Okay. So I don't want to touch it. Just put it in the box. Just slide it in there. Okay, and then you can hand me this as well. All right, we will come back to the cards in a moment. Do you like red?
No.
Or do you like blue?
Blue.
All right, that's for you. All right, so here's my red. And there's your blue. So when you have to figure out people, here's the secret. This has taken me years to figure out. Most people are concerned about one of five things. Number one, this is their health. This reminds me of the sun. It's completeness. Believe it or not, one time or another we'll be concerned about our health. They say the person that has 100 goals is really healthy, but the person that is kind of sick only has one goal. You look pretty healthy. So health, believe it or not, health is something that people come to me for, they talk to me about, or you meet people that are concerned about health. These are symbols, because symbols communicate better than words. The other one is relationships. This is love. This is husband, wife, brother, sister. This is connection. This could be connection with the universe. If you believe in a higher power, this is connection. People are dying for connection. The last couple of years have been crazy. This is three lines which represents currency. Currency is money flowing into your life, money flowing out. It's what money can buy. I knew money wasn't an issue for you. I knew that you weren't focused on that. But some people, their whole life is about making money. And then the next one is emotionally, it's like a house, it's a foundation, it's solid. This is emotions. It could be love, it could be any emotion, the opposite of anxiety, the opposite of anger. Believe it or not, you could have great relationships, but if your emotional life, you know, is lacking, like whatever, you know, think of an emotion, whatever emotion you can think of, it has to do with this area. I want to improve. I want to have more of this emotion, and it's not anger, right? And then lastly, it is the star, which is your career, your calling. So when I meet people, I size them up. I called Stephanie ahead of time. I wanted to get to know her. I wanted to listen to her. I met her before. I met some of you before. You do this. I do this. We read people. We read people in an instant. Do I like this person? Faux, Fred. What I go is I go a different level because I'm not thinking about myself because I'm a Dale Carnegie graduate. I'm thinking about who is this person?
Brooke.
Yeah, yeah. And Brooke, don't say it because you'll ruin the finale. Brooke has something that's important to her, really important to her. And I don't know what it is right now, but she knows. It's one thing, you wrote it down. She knows it. It's a secret. We're going to see if we can figure it out. So, this is health, this is relationships, this is money, this is emotions, this is career. So what I'd like you to do is take your next actually, I'm going to come over here with my pad. There are crayons over here. There's a black crayon. I'll give it to you to make it a lot easier. There's a black crayon. I would like you to draw what I just put on the board. And I'm going to draw two. Do you have, okay, you have the crayon. I have some crayons too. So I'm going to draw the circle and the X and the squiggly lines and the square, which is the motion, and then the other one, which is career. Why don't you stand on this side and I'll switch with you. Okay. Now what I'd like you to do, Brooke, is if you're concerned about your health, circle the circle, but don't do it now. If it's relationships, circle the relationships, cross. If it's the three lines, which is money, 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 you'll circle that. If it's emotions like joy or love or happiness or whatever you think about, you would circle the square. And if it's career, you're going to circle the other one. I'm going to circle what I think. I'm just going to make a guess because I have no idea exactly if I'll be right. I have a choice of like one in five. Okay? Did you do it?
Yes.
Okay, excellent. Now next to you is a box of crayons. Do you see them? Okay. There are colors. They're primary colors. Take a look. There's a red. You can take a look at it. Because you're going to choose one of those in a moment. So there's a red, blue, yellow, green. Choose one now while my back is turned. One crayon. Just choose one crayon. Got it?
Mm-hmm.
All right. So I'd like you to take that crayon, whatever it is, and color in the object that you colored. And I'm going to do my best to do the same. I have a couple crayons here. Now this is rapport 101, and this is what I teach people in sales. Are you done? Okay, here's my pad. I'm going to give it to you, and I'm going to take a look at what you wrote, and let's see if Brooke and I are on the same page. You circled the square, and you colored it in orange, and I colored it in orange as well. That's rapport. Isn't that amazing? Okay, and I'll tell you why I know that we're in rapport. We had two separate decks. You shuffled it and I shuffled it. Do you remember? Watch this. Come over here. Face the audience. Never turn your back on the audience. You can never trust these people. All right. Two cards. Remember? This was your card. Take a look at it. This was my card. Take a look at it and tell the audience if they are the same. What do they say?
Free yourself to fly with your imagination.
Free yourself to fly with your imagination. Brooke, thank you so much for making this wonderful. So that concludes my lecture. I will tell you that all of my notes are at gregdwyer.com. So all you have to do is go to gregdwyer.com. and send me an email, and I will send you a full PDF of all the details, all the information, and all the secrets that you're wanting to know about this. So if you want to know more, you got to go to gregdwyer.com, and when you go to gregdwyer.com, you'll get all my notes. So here's a notebook that I have. And every single thing that I have in here is a word. Like this says multitasking. This says seven, because I said seven in red. Every single page has a different word. And I always look at this. You can ask my friend Fran. I always look at this before the lecture so that I remember this stuff. And I know what to share with you. So here we're going to play a little game in closing. I'm gonna take this ball and I'm gonna throw it. First person to get it, grab it. Who got it? Who's got it? Who's got it? Who's got it? Okay, good. You can stand up. That's fine. We didn't plan this. I'd like you to name a number. So we got all of these pages here. We have all, by the way, I don't know if anybody can see it, but they're all different. Can you run up and see real quick to see that they're all different? Every single one of these pages is different.
Yeah.
Not one of them is the same. So name a number between 1 and 20, any number.
1.
What is it?
1.
12. I love 12. I'm glad you didn't say 7. So willpower is 3, 8, 9, 10. 10 is autopilot. Remember, autopilot, TWA, change our thoughts, change our destiny. 11, you said what, 12? 12? You said, what did you say?
1.
You said 1, no, between. So I heard 12. What did you say?
12.
No, 1.
12.
12.
12.
You want to go with 12 or you want to go something else?
12 is fine.
Okay, all right. I'm sorry. 1 through, first page is there. So we have here, come up real quick and take a look at what's written on this page. What does that say?
Focus.
Focus. Bill Gates, Warren Buffett sit down at a wedding. And they asked them to write down one word. And they wrote down one word, and the other person wrote down the other word. They didn't look at it, and they flipped it over, and believe it or not, the word was focus. So what did you write down? Yeah.
What?
Yeah, just that.
I did my name.
Oh. Check the piece of paper. And it's probably the other one, because I had to make two of them. What's it say?
Focus.
Thank you so much. Please reach out to me, brentdwyer.com. Stay focused and ask me for the notes. Thank you so much. I appreciate it. Thank you.
Very good.